to Mayanna and Stephanie to for their kind invitation to come here and present my research. And you have to be either very brave or completely crazy to come to the IOP and talk about the anatomy of white matter, because we all know that this institute is one of the leading centers in the world for research in the anatomy of white matter using advanced diffusion and cartography. But the reality is that I will talk about a different technique, which is an old method to investigate the anatomy of white matter fibrous tracts using the Klingler method that was developed by a Swiss neuroanatomist. And this is a classical method of post-mortem dissection. As you know, my background is clinical, mainly clinical, but I have a research interest as well. And I will try to focus the research and put this research in the context of the clinical relevance and clinical application. I will start with a quick historical background, and then I will illustrate the technique, how you actually perform the dissection on post-mortem specimen, and then I will present some the results of my PhD work that have been done in collaboration mainly with this institute. Going back in time, we can see that Vesalius, the father of modern anatomy, was the first to clearly differentiate between gray and white matter. And he identified the corpus callosum, which is, as you know, the most prominent white matter structure. And he understood that this was a connection between the two hemispheres. But we have to wait until the 17th century with Thomas Willis and Nicolaus Steno to have the first attempt to actually dissect the white matter tract. And at that time, the technical limitation was that they were trying to do dissection on fresh post-mortem specimen. So there was no preparation, and they were trying just to scrape the gray matter and then look at the connectivity, the connection of the white matter on fresh specimen. And this was quite difficult to know, because even when you do surgery and you go into the white matter on inpatient or on a fresh post-mortem specimen, the white matter appears like an homogeneous white jelly matter. So it's actually difficult to identify, almost impossible to identify the tract. One prominent neuroanatomist of the time was Raymond de Bussel, and he was one of the first to actually give an accurate description of his technique of white matter fiber dissection. He improved the technique by boiling the brains in oil, and he kept this brain boiling in water so that the gray matter was basically liquefying, and then he was able to have a better depiction of the white matter tract. He described the centrum semiovale and gave the first description of the continuity of the pyramidal tract. It is interesting to see that his better anatomical understanding was still heavily influenced by the theory of Galen about the animal spirit that was permeating the white matter tract. And he said that the different and inexplicable ways that it is permeated resemble the intricate composition and architecture of the white matter. Going later in time, the method of dissection was improved by Johannes Christenreihl, a German neuroanatomist, who started to fix the brain in alcohol. So we moved from dissection of fresh specimen to a first attempt to fix the brain. And they used the alcohol at the time. And this improved the technique of white matter dissection. And he identified and described more in detail the corona radiata. And this allowed also other investigators, prominent neuroanatomists, Burdach, Gratiolet, but also think about Degerim and Vic Desir, who described the more complex white matter structures. like the arcuate fasciculus, or the optic pathway, the mammillothalamic tract by Vigdazir, and so on. And so we come to Joseph Klingler at the beginning of last century. He improved further the technique of white matter dissection. Klingler was not a doctor, he was an anatomical preparator working at the University of Basel. And he had the idea of freezing brains that were previously fixed in formalin, so that the water that was trapped into the brain by the freezing process could spread apart the white matter tracts. And this could then facilitate the dissection. And I will show how it works in practice. He published his main work in 1956, but the first description of the technique was in a paper published in German in 1936. So the Atlas of the Human Brain published in 1956 is basically the coronation of 20 years of work. And as you can see, the first name on the publication is the name of his professor, the director of the... After he did all the work, the first name was the name of his professor, because he was not a doctor, and particularly at that time, it was not felt appropriate for someone who didn't have a medical degree to publish as a first name. So his chair, the chair of his department got the credit after he did all the work. I don't know if these things don't happen anymore nowadays, but you know. So he gave a very complete and detailed description of the white matter fascicles. And I like to remember him for his legacy also in neurosurgery. Yazagil, who some of you may know, was and he has been still alive, but he's retired now. He has been the most prominent neurosurgeon of this century, I would say. He is the one that developed the technique of micro neurosurgery. And as a young medical student in Basel, he used to attend the teaching sessions provided by Klingler, and he acknowledged Klingler in a lot of his papers. And Yazagil, among his contribution to neurosurgery, also drove the attention of neurosurgeons to the white matter and its importance when we actually operate on the brain. How does it work in practice, the Klingler method? So the first step, these are specimens that have been prepared in Newcastle, where I did my PhD work. The brain is first of all fixed in 10% formalin solution for a minimum of 40 days. I usually keep them a little bit longer, 2 to 3 months, so that they are fixed in formalin. The second step is to completely remove the arachnoid and the pia mater with all the vessels, and you have the identification of the surface anatomy in terms of sulci and gyri. So you can see this is a right specimen. The crucial step, as we mentioned, is the freezing process. The brains are frozen and kept in a refrigerator at minus 10, 15 degrees for approximately a couple of weeks. And as you can see, when the brain is frozen, the ice forms between the fibers, and these loose up the brain substance, thus facilitating the dissection when the brain are then taken out of the freezer and they are thawed. The instruments that you use for the dissection are nothing fancy, really. You have homemade wooden spatulas. This is a blunt dissector, similar to the one that we use when we do real operations. And you can use loops for more refined dissection. But always keeping in mind that mentem et manum adibere, so the mind and the hand are important and not just the instruments that you use. I will now quickly expose how you proceed step by step. The first thing is the removal of the superficial gray matter to expose the new fibers. This is a right specimen. And we are dissecting the central sulcus, exposing these new fibers that run around the hand knob in this region. So this is the central sulcus completely dissected, and you can appreciate these U fibers that are running around the hand knob, represented by the green pin. This is the equivalent in real post-mortem dissection of the tractography that has been published by Catani in his paper on the frontal lobe connections. You know, when he described the poppy flower connection, this is the equivalent in a real brain. Again, another example of U fibers. This is again a right specimen, the superior frontal gyrus divided, and you can appreciate the U fibers that run along the sulci of the superior frontal gyrus. As you go on with the dissection and you go deeper in your dissection of the white matter, you can appreciate again U fibers running along. So this is the right frontal lobe with the inferior frontal gyrus, and you can see here again U fibers connecting the opercular portion with the pyramidal and then with the orbital portion of the inferior frontal gyrus. You can see the arcuate fasciculus SLF exposed, so this is a deep longitudinal, a long longitudinal tract. And here it's not very clear in the picture, but here behind the SLF you can see the vertical projection of the corona radiata. So you can also appreciate the 3D relationship of the white matter fibers with this technique. So you have a superficial layer of the fibers, the deep longitudinal tracts, and even deeper the corona radiata that goes behind. And this is another example taken by a paper that was published by Huang about the arcuate fasciculus. Again, here at the AOP you have this beautiful illustration provided by the group of Catania about the arcuate fasciculus. This is the equivalent in the post-mortem dissection. I have to talk a little bit about the limits of this technique as well. So the first limit that has particularly affected me is the availability of specimen. While it may be slightly easier to find a bunch of healthy volunteers, particularly if they are MD or PhD students, to do your tractography studies, it is not so easy to get the post-mortem specimen for obvious reasons. So you need a huge center where there is a large brain bank that can supply the specimen. And there are a lot of regulations, you know, it goes under the Tissue Regulatory Act, so you have, you know, to go to two stages of ethic committee to get the approval. So it took me 1 year from the time I started to apply to have the specimen by the time I got to the first specimen. There can be problem in the specimen preparation, particularly if the freezing is not done appropriately or the fixation of formalin is not done appropriately. The problem of the technique which is shared with the tractography is the blending of fibers. So when two tracts run very close to each other, or there is a crossing of fibers, then again, if you don't follow your tracts, you can have trouble, as you can cut through the layers of fibers and get spurious tracts, generate false results, and as outlined there. So this is an example of a poor formalin fixation. We tried to do dissection in this brain, but this was not properly. Something went wrong with the formalin, and it was just melting down as you tried to dissect. So you need a specimen that has been properly fixed in formalin. And this is an example of a difficult dissection. This was the IFOF, the inferior frontal occipital fasciculus, that you can see all dissected from its frontal termination to its parietal occipital with a little bit of temporal component as well. You can see the fan, and this has also been described with the tractography. The difficulty here was to follow the fibers of the IFOF, avoiding cutting through the optic radiation. And the thing that you can do to avoid that is to start at the frontal end of the tract and follow it down to the occipital. If you do the other way around, you start at the occipital, you then can run into the optic radiation and then lose your tract as you go on. As you go on, you can go too deep in the dissection. regional optic radiations are deeper to the IFOF. What can this technique do? It is a tool for anatomical investigation, so it is a good way to study the anatomy. And you can use it to identify new tracts and to have a better view of the cortical termination of bundles. As a neurosurgeon, I found it very helpful in giving me an understanding of the 3D anatomy. When you do your dissection in the lab and then you translate these into your surgical practice, it gives you a real good understanding of the 3D anatomy, so that when you are planning the approach to a deep-seated lesion, then you have already in your mind how the fibers are directed and where you can go, the corridors that you can use as a surgeon. Of course, then you can use a tractography coupled with neural navigation, but if you have a training there and a background, you've done this in your real life, and you've seen with your eyes, you have a even better anatomical understanding. We found this very useful as a complementary tool to tractography. There's always been a little bit of a querel, whether it's tractography gives you better results or if you need to go back to this old technique of the section. But the reality is that they are complementary and you can use one to validate the other. And that's what we have done in a few papers. And of course, putting everything together, it is ultimately a way to understand and study the brain connectivity and the brain networks. And I hope that I will be able to give you an idea of all these aspects by just showing you some of the results that we obtain, some of the results that I obtained in my PhD. So the first study that we did, and this was in collaboration with Stephanie, was to study the intralobar fibers of the occipital lobe. The first description, complete description of the white matter fibers of the occipital lobe was provided by Heinrich Sachs in 1892, but very little attention was paid since after, despite the clinical relevance that this connection may have in real clinical practice. And again, although the occipital lobe, apart from the primary visual area and the optical radiation, has always been considered as relatively non-functional areas, particularly by gross clinicians like me, we have seen that in a recent clinical study, the importance of white matter has been underlined, and there have been publications by neurosurgeons about the importance of the white matter anatomy. And so from here we started and we identified this connection as of potential interest. And so our aim was to investigate the white matter anatomy, and we decided to compare our results with the description that were originally provided by Sachs. We used two different techniques, because of Sachs at that time, and Stephanie knows very well because she translated kindly all these atlas from German to English. Sachs used histological preparation with hematoxylin and picocarmine stain. So this was a classic histological technique that's applied, while we employed the freezing technique of Klingler. And this is the result that we obtained. On the left, you have the original slide of Sachs with his histological preparation. This is the diagram that he prepared after his result. And on the right is the dissection that we did with the Klingler technique. This is a section taken at the posterior edge of the corpus callosum, going just anterior, so we are just anterior to the occipital lobe. And what you can appreciate is the anatomy with the ventricle, which is particularly prominent in this specimen there. You have the superior parietal lobe, the inferior parietal lobe, the cilium fissure there, the superior, middle, and inferior temporal gyrus, the collateral sulcus dividing the fusiform gyrus from the parahippocampal gyrus with the hippocampus here and the fornix starting just there. on top of the ventricle, you have the splenium of the corpus callosum with the fibers of the trapezium that come around like a fan and embrace the lateral wall of the ventricle. And just lateral to the fibers of the trapezium, you have longitudinal fibers, 4 and 5, that are the fibers of the stratum sagittale. This would be the optic radiation and the IFOF together. And number 6 is the arcuate fasciculus as it comes and cross around. Going posteriorly at the section that it is at the level of the anterior edge of the calcarine fissure, you can identify on the lateral aspect of the occipital lobe the superior, middle, and the inferior occipital gyri, the collateral sulcus again. This is the calcarine fissure. The ventricle is much less prominent at this level. And again, you can see some fibers of the forceps major on top. These are again coming from the corpus callosum. And laterally, again, these are fibers of the stratum sagittale. More medially, close to the calcarine fissure, you have new fibers that go from the superior to the inferior edge of the calcarine fissure. Going again more posteriorly, getting a cross-section at the level of the cuneus and the mid-portion of the calcarine fissure, we can again appreciate the superficial anatomy with the occipital gyri, the collateral sulcus that becomes more deep and indenting the occipital lobe as we go posteriorly. The ventricle is almost a virtual cavity at this level, because you know that as you go posteriorly, the ventricle tends to narrow down. You have again the calcarine fissure. The white matter is arranged at this level, and this is nicely described by Sachs, like the layers of an onion skin around the ventricle. So you have more superficially here new fibers that connect the neighboring occipital gyri. As you go more deeper, you can see this longitudinal bundle of fibers that was called the deep layer of the convexity by Sachs. Coming close to the ventricle wall, again the fibers of the stratum sagittale, and medially to the ventricle, again these fibers connecting the superior to the inferior portion of the calcarine fissure. And this is even more clear if you do the stepwise dissection according to the Klingler method that I showed you before. So if you go deep to the parieto-occipital sulcus, again you find these new fibers that connect the precuneus to the cuneus. And if you go deep and do your dissection at the level of the calcarine fissure, again you have new fibers running from the superior edge to the inferior edge of the calcarine fissure. And we identified this longitudinal tract that goes from the cuneus to the anterior portion, to the anterior portion of the lingula, where the lingula blends with the inferior edge of the parietocampal gyrus, so the parieto-occipital junction. And the proposed name for this tract is the sledge runner. This was again identified by Catania and confirmed by postmortem dissection. And it is a newly identified tract. The lateral dissection gives you the result that I've illustrated before, again the new fibers that you can see nicely dissected here. This is the deep layer of the convexity that goes from the top until the bottom, and it's vertically oriented from up to superior to the inferior edge of the occipital lobe. And this is the stratum sagittale with the ventricle there. And as you do your dissection deeper, coming closer to the ventricle, you can see that the stratum sagittale has an external layer that corresponds to the IFOF and an internal layer that corresponds to the optic radiation, and number 2 and 3 there. The clinical relevance, as we said before, because of my clinical background, I always try to see the relevance that this can have in my clinical practice. Well, this group, which is a group of Professor Dufour in Montpellier, induced semantic paraphasia
by stimulating the fibers of the stratum sagittale at the deep end of the resection of an occipital lobe glioma. So as they were doing the resection, they found at the bottom end of their resection fibers that were of the stratum sagittale, and they induced this semantic paraphilia. So again, the potential clinical relevance of this connection. So this study showed a good concordance between our dissection and the old classic histological preparations made by Sachs. We described the rich network of occipital interlobar fibers, including a previously unrecognized and newly identified tract, for which the proposed name is the sledgehammer. And we have talked about the surgical relevance of this connection. The next paper is about the connection of the supplementary motor area. You know that the supplementary motor area is that region, mesial region of the frontal lobe that sits just in front of the primary motor cortex. And again, as a neurosurgeon, this is extremely important to us because it is frequently involved by tumors and particularly by low-grade gliomas. So around 15 to 20% of low-grade gliomas and up to 8% of high-grade glioma tend to involve this region. Surgery in this region, when you do an operation, you take out the tumor, can be followed by the supplementary motor area syndrome that was originally described by a French neurosurgeon, Laplan, in 1977. And this is characterized by contralateral akinesia, so the patient is unable to move, and mutism if surgery is done in the dominant hemisphere. Patients tend to improve, and they usually take a maximum of 3 months to recover from their supplementary motor area syndrome. Sometimes the improvement and the recovery is not complete, and they may be left with a subtle deficit, particularly in terms of bilateral manual coordination or subtle language deficit, like anomia or difficulty to talk under stressful condition or to talk for a long period of time. The connection of the SMA have been extensively investigated in the non-human primate, right, the study of Lupino and Rizzolatti. And therefore, there were only limited data about the SMA connection in humans. So we decided to apply the Klingler technique and DTI tartography. This was done by Luis and Flavio Dell'Acqua. And we used these anatomical findings to try and have a better understanding of the SMA syndrome. The first step is to identify our supplementary motor area. So this is a right-sided hemisphere. If you trace a line from the anterior to the posterior commission, and you draw the perpendicular at the level of the anterior commission, you can classically distinguish by a posterior portion of your SMA. This is the paracentral lobule with the central sulcus. So this is our primary motor strip. And this is the primary somatosensory area. Okay? So this is the precentral, postcentral sulcus. This is the precentral sulcus. And here, in front, we have our supplementary motor area. That is divided by an SMA proper. And in front, you have a pre-SMA. The first step in the dissection was to dissect the precentral sulcus. And what we found is, again, new fibers running from the pre-SMA, from the SMA proper to the primary motor cortex. And this was nicely verified with the tartography study. Going deeper with the dissection, we identify a longitudinal tract, vertically oriented, that goes from the pre-SMA, it's really the junction between the SMA proper and pre-SMA, going down to the opercular portion of the inferior frontal gyrus that in the dominant hemisphere
represents the classically described Broca area. Here you can see the SLF that has been cut, so these fibers run deeper to the SLF. And here is another example of a completely dissected Aslan tract. The name that has been given to this tract is the frontal Aslan tract because it has this curvilinear direction. And this has also been described and nicely described by the tractography standards. And you can see that it goes from the pre-SMA, SMA proper region, down to the inferior frontal gyrus, the opercular portion mainly. And this can represent a connection, direct connection, between the supplementary motor area and the Broca area. As we go on the mesial portion of the hemisphere, so the first step was the dissection of the convexity of the brain, now we move on to the mesial portion, and we dissect the cingulate sulcus, again identify new fibers running between the supplementary motor area and the cingulate gyrus. So this is the corpus callosum. Superior to the corpus callosum we have the cingulate gyrus, and this is the cingulate sulcus dissected. We started out with the spatula to show these new fibers. And again, this was verified with the tractography study. Going deeper, you expose the fibers of the corpus callosum, and removing the fibers of the corpus callosum, running deep to the corpus callosum, you have fibers that connect the supplementary motor area to the caudate. This is the head of the caudate, right down here. You have the caudate running, and you can see these fibers converging onto the caudate nucleus. So this was a connection between the SMA and the striatum, of which the caudate is part. Again, another picture to show these fibers going to the head of the caudate here, from coming down from the supplementary motor area. And this again was nicely illustrated with the tractography. Can we use these anatomical findings to have or try and have a better explanation of the supplementary motor area syndrome? Well, we have seen that the SMA plays an important role in movement, particularly in the initiation of movement. And we have described this new connection, new fiber connection between the SMA proper and the primary motor cortex, and there, of course, a connection with the corticospinal tract. And this can play a role in the execution of movement. But we have also seen a diffuse connection from the SMA to the striatum. And we know from the work of Alexander and Kracher that these fibers are part of a larger network that goes from the cortex to the striatum, basal ganglia, thalamus, and that reverberate back to the cortex. And this can be important in planning and initiate movement. And in those more complex and more fine motor tasks that I was telling you about before, like bilateral motor control and bimanual coordination, that are affected, and we see quite often affected in patients that have surgery in the supplementary motor area. SMA plays also an important role in language, and we have seen a direct connection via the Aslan tract between the pre-SMA and the Broca area. And this can be important in the initiation of speech. But we have also seen a connection via the new fibers between the SMA proper and the cingulate, and this can be a connection with the limbic system, between the SMA and the limbic system via the cingulate, that you know is part via the cingulum, is part of the papal circuit. And this can play a role in the emotional aspect of language. Some of these patients, after surgery in the SMA area, recover a good speech function, grossly speaking. But they tell you that if they are under stress or if they get nervous and emotional, they start to have anomia again, like they used to have after their surgery. This is a study again from the group of Dufour that can help us to explain the role of SMA in language. their group studied the somatotopy of the supplementary motor area, and what they found is that the language, so they were stimulating intraoperatively the SMA, and they found the language response at the level of the junction between the pre-SMA and the SMA proper, exactly where we found anatomically the termination of the frontal aslant trunk. These studies have been then updated because they've done subcortical stimulation of the frontal aslant trunk, finding again some result, some positive result with the stimulation, so to confirming that the frontal aslant trunk can play an important role in language. And the group of Catania has also published an important paper about the role of the frontal aslant trunk in progressive aphasia. Conclusions of this work, we have seen a good concordance in this case between the Klingler dissection and our tractography result. So you remember what I said before, that you can use the two techniques to complement each other, and if you want to make the result of your research even more robust, because if you send a paper to a journal to be reviewed, then you present your result with two techniques, and you can say, well, these are the results. You know, they can't say, well, it's an artifact or should do better. I mean, this is clearly validating the result. We have demonstrated that the SMA is, again, a large network of connection with motor, language, and limbic areas, and they can inform the neurosurgeon treating patients with tumors in the supplementary motor area on what to expect after the surgery, and this can be important in patient counseling and also to plan the recovery after surgery, because just looking at the MRI, you can even better if you do tractography before operating, you can then know where the tumor is, which kind of deficit you can expect and predict after surgery, and so that you can plan the rehabilitation of the patient after. The third paper, and I promise this is the last one, because it's taking long, is a paper that is still in preparation. This is about the connectivity of the subcallosal cingulate region, which is the region of the cingulate gyrus, immediately below the genu of the corpus callosum. Subcallosal cingulate area has been identified as a new target for deep brain stimulation in functional neurosurgery. Deep brain stimulation is a neurosurgical technique. All come, as you can see from my clinical background, is a neurosurgical intervention where you implant electrodes in the brain to stimulate the brain in order to have a clinical effect on your patient. The main application of this deep brain stimulation technique is for movement disorder. I'm sure you have heard about DBS for Parkinson's disease and for dystonia, where you implant gray nuclei. You implant usually the globus pallidus or the subthalamic nucleus for Parkinson. But there has been a lot of interest recently about the application of this deep brain stimulation to treat psychiatric disorders like depression, obviously very severe cases of treatment-resistant depression, or even anorexia nervosa. There are only very limited data about the connectivity of this region, and there are a couple of DTI studies that have not, nobody has ever done a study using this post-mortem dissection. And again, a better knowledge of the connectivity of this area, that is broader than area 25, but the concept is beyond the broader than area 25, and I'll tell you why. So a better knowledge of the connectivity of this region can help to understand the mechanism of deep brain stimulation in this region. These are a couple of studies from the literature. This was a study by the group of Lozano from Toronto about implanting electrodes in this region to treat the depression. And this is about its clinical application for anorexia nervosa. This is not a new target. It was already seen in
all the literature that if you do a lesion in this part of the brain that goes from A to A first here, you can have a clinical effect in your psychiatric patient. And this was done again for the treatment of depression, severe depression, by King's neurosurgeon, Jeffrey Knight, who was based at the Brooks at the time, but then the Brooks melted with the Mosley to give the King's neurosurgical unit. And in the 60s, he was doing lesional neurosurgical operation to interrupt the connection that were at the level of this subgenual cingulate area. So the aim of the study is again to investigate the white matter connection with post-mortem dissection, and I'm still chasing Flavio to give me the final results of his stratigraphy. That's why the paper is still in preparation. And we want to interpret the anatomical findings to have a better understanding of DBS for psychiatric disorder. So again, going back to the anatomy, I know you're tired now, but I promise that this is the last presentation. So this is again a right hemisphere. You can see here the corpus callosum with the rostrum, the genu, the body and the spleen. These are the four parts where you divide the corpus callosum. This is the subgenual cingulate area. This is the cingulus that embraces and goes around with this C-shape, the corpus callosum. And here you have the frontal gyri with the rectus gyrus and the para-olfactory gyri there. As we do our dissection again, the first tract to be identified is the cingulum. This has been well described in old anatomical study and with modern tractography. The cingulum goes all around the corpus callosum to terminate in the parahippocampal region, in the parahippocampal gyrus. It has a prominent, there is a prominent contingent of fibers at the level of the parietal lobe. Eh? It gives these, with number five here, you can see these fibers that take off and terminate at the level of the, this would be the equivalent of the superior parietal lobe on the mesial hemisphere, so it's the precuneus. And anteriorly, you can say these U fibers that are better seen here, U fibers that go to the frontopolar regions. And these are a connection between the subgenual area and the fibers that go to the frontopolar regions. As you go deeper with your dissection, you find the fibers of the uncinate fasciculus that go very close and pass, just go at the inferior edge of this subgenual area. You see, the subgenual area is represented always by this red pin, and you can see here how close the fibers of the uncinate fasciculus run to this area. So we didn't see termination of the uncinate fasciculus here, but you can imagine that if you put an electrode over the red pin here, you are actually stimulating the cingulum, these fibers, and the uncinate fasciculus as well. But that's what you do in real clinical terms, when you put the electrode there and you give your stimulation. And again, we found a little contingent of fibers that run to the accumbens. And from the frontal lobe, they go all the way down, it's number two here, to the accumbens. And this is the accumbens frontal tract. White matter fibers is a functional target in neurosurgery, and this is not a entirely new concept. You know that historically the leucotomy that was originally developed by Edgar Smonis, a Portuguese neurologist, was targeted to divide the frontal connection of, the white matter connection of the frontal lobe in patients with depression and schizophrenia. And this has been seen also in the treatment of obsessive compulsive disorder, where you stimulate the internal capsule. It's been seen with our study and study of others, obviously, in the subgenual cingulate region, and the forest field and the zone inserta for Parkinson's disease. So even in movement disorder, some theories say that even if you put the electrode in the subthalamic nucleus, for example, what is actually relevant to the clinical effect that you see in Parkinson's is not the stimulation of the nucleus, but the stimulation of the white matter around the nucleus. And this makes sense in terms of physiology, because actually what you do in functional neurosurgery is modulate a network. And to modulate a network, you can obviously stimulate a station along the network, or even the connection that forms part of the network. And that's why I was, at the beginning, I said that even if in the literature you see that people talk about stimulation of area 25, this is, in my opinion, misleading, because it's not the cortical area that is important, it's the white matter connection of that region that plays a role in the clinical effect of deep brain stimulation. And this is the network that we have identified. So around the subgenual area, you have this connection, you remember, that goes anteriorly to the orbitofrontal cortex, that is obviously important in decision-making and reward-based decision-making. You have the connection to the ventral portion of the striatum, the accumbens, that plays an important role in pleasure, for example. You have obviously the cingulum, that is part of the Papez circuit, one of the major components of the limbic system, and you have connection via the uncinate fasciculus to the mesotemporal region, which again can, you know, play an important role in integrating emotion and memory. And a final slide, just to show that if you apply this concept of stimulating a network by stimulating the white matter, then your anatomical target becomes the tracts that you see in the MRI of your patient. And so there's been the idea of actually using DTI tractography to identify in patients what the target for deep brain stimulation should be. So you can do your tractography and then use that tractography-based MRI to guide the implant of the electrode. Future studies, just a quick mention. We are putting together the idea and the project to map important areas for language, and this is something that I will be hopefully developing in the next months, working at King's College Hospital and doing a neuro-oncology and translating this into translating the research into clinical application, and see whether we can again verify some of this connection, and for example the role of the frontal aslant tract in surgery for brain tumors. And then there is also an idea, we are a little bit stuck on this project, but there was the idea of doing a tractography on post-mortem specimens, so that you can, to even better validate the two techniques, you can do the tractography and the post-mortem dissection on the same specimen. Let's see if we'll be able. Just a quick slide just to acknowledge and thank all the people that have been involved in these few projects, and they gave me a hand. So Juan Martino is a good friend and a neurosurgical colleague who works in this beautiful place that is Santander in Spain. And we met in Montpellier where we started to do the dissection, and we still keep in contact. And all the people at that brain lab here, I'm sure this is, I haven't mentioned all the people that I should be thankful to, but obviously the NAT Brain Lab has played a major role in helping me to develop all this research. And finally, obviously, all the people up in Newcastle, where I was previously based, and where I did at the Institute of Neuroscience, the brain bank that they have there is really well organized. And so all these people supported me in providing the specimen for the research and helped me to devise this project. So thank you. To you as well for your attention. You're still alive.
Any questions?
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I actually have a few questions. Did you see the arcuate in the right hemisphere?
The arcuate fasciculus in the right hemisphere? Yes, but I don't have many data about that, because I never focus on the arcuate fasciculus, to be honest, with my dissection.
Yeah.
I've seen it, but it was, you know, it's always like something in the way
to dissect other tracts. So I never focused my attention specifically on the arcuate fascicles.
And would you say that, so coming from the tractography end, clinging letter section is always seen as the gold standard to validate DTI with. Do you think it is the gold standard, or is it still quite user-dependent and knowledge-dependent?
So the way we used clinging dissection was much more fluid and flexible way. So the reality is that because I had a few specimens available, I was guiding my dissection informed on tractography results. Mm-hmm. So we tried to validate the tractography by seeing, and sometimes the other way around happened as well. So I found some tract and said, well, can you actually see this on tractography? And the answer was yes. Mm-hmm. So as I said, it's difficult to really say which one is the gold standard. I think that Klingler technique is a type of, and it's been validated for many, many years. And it is still useful despite the